So I'm off this morning having my COVID jab at the hospital. I seem to have got an appointment and was sent away for 10 to 11 this morning. So I'm pre-recording this. I'm in the study, so a different backdrop. Lorraine's in the dining room, but we're not at the same time. This is not live. And I'm going to attempt to try and be live and not robotic when I record this. The reason that we choose to do it live normally is because Lorraine and I tend to be a little bit more robotic and worry about tripping up words a bit more, when actually we just want to present what God's saying to our hearts to you each morning. So anyway, I'm going to do this now. This is it's actually Friday morning as I'm recording this, but we're continuing our series through our 10 Marks of Wonderful Church. We really feel like it's important that we keep these on the agenda for us. As we learn and we discover more about what God's saying to us through these 10 marks for us as a church, an expression of God's love in this city. So let me just give you a bit of history. For some, this might be the first time. For others, you might have heard us say some of this before, but it's important that we understand what these 10 marks are and equally what they're not. So just a bit of history. When God spoke to us in the middle of the night, us, Gary and Lorraine, in the middle of the night, back in the early part of 2018, with this list of what a wonderful church looks like, and we had no idea what he would do with it. It was quite simply a moment when we both woke up simultaneously, around about 3 a.m., and we wrote down these 10 marks of wonderful church. We didn't know what he was going to do. We certainly didn't know how useful that list would be, or indeed what it was for. We were still at Sherburn Hill, our previous appointment, when he gave us his list. And we decided, as we do often, we just feel like it's for the moment. So we shared it and began to teach on this list of 10 marks. But we really felt like it wasn't having an impact at Sherburn Hill. Then we got the appointment to Peterborough, and we began praying into what the ministry there would look like, and we returned to this list of 10 marks. We prayed some more and felt God leading us to use these things, these 10 marks at our welcome meeting. That's what it's called when you're installed like a gas cooker in the Salvation Army, at the welcome meeting. And we delivered it together, which was unusual for us. We'd never really delivered teaching as a team effort before. It didn't go without its hitches, and we forgot some of the order of the list, but there we are, that was history. But we faithfully did what we felt God was doing. And as regular public speakers and spiritual leaders, I guess we develop, like all who do this often, develop a discernment about whether what you're saying is landing as God intended it to on the hearers in front of you. And we really felt God affirm the 10 marks of wonderful church in that moment and ongoing over the next, what has turned out so far to be almost 3 years. So just a reminder, this is not a definitive list, an exhaustive list. This is literally a moment when God inspired us to take stock of what ministry had been like at that point, 16 years now, nearly 19 years of spiritual church leadership in various socio-economic settings. So this is a reflection on those years of ministry in different places. So it's not an exhaustive list. It's not even an structural or instructive list. It's turned out that at Peterborough Citadel, as it happens, we've begun using this list of marks to measure and chart the growth and missional effectiveness and development. But in its purest form, this is an observational list. We've observed that when these 10 things are present, church is wonderful, God glorifying, community changing, missionally effective, life healing, disciple making, healthily growing into the likeness of God, and growing numerically. When these marks are not present, either one of them or all of them, those things that we all desire from church and what the world desperately needs from the church, are just not there. Church is not wonderful. So, why am I telling you this in the middle of Lent? Next Sunday is Palm Sunday. We're marching ever closer towards Easter. And it may seem odd that we're sticking with a series on what has become Peterborough Citadel's effectiveness measuring tools. Hopefully, as I go on this morning, and I hope I'm not going on, you will agree soon enough this is entirely appropriate. So as Jesus got nearer to the cross, I would postulate these 10 marks become more and more evident. All the marks of the church that his death and resurrection cleared the way for were manifest in Jesus's inner private life with his Father, his relationship with his disciples, and his interaction with the world. In short, how Jesus was with the Father, with his friends, with the world on his journey to the cross is a picture of what church should look like. So today, I'd like to focus. Lorraine launched off a couple of weeks ago, or it might have been last week, can't remember. Anyway, Lorraine launched off with the first of our marks, which is love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul and mind. And today we're going to focus on the second of those marks. Our list is not necessarily in any kind of priority order, but it did seem appropriate that love the Lord your God, heart, soul and mind was first, and pray, be still, be silent often was next, hot on the heels. So we're going to look at prayer this morning. And the most famous of Jesus's prayer is what we know as the Lord's Prayer. And this was a response to a question from his disciples after they had observed his behaviour. The verse is on the screen for you just now. And it says, Luke chapter 11, verse 1. One day Jesus was praying in a certain place. When he finished, one of his disciples said to him, Lord, teach us to pray, just as John taught his disciples. The fact that this question and subsequent teaching is the result of learned behaviour by observation should be a stark lesson to all of us who lead anyone, or indeed parent anyone. I was watching with Lorraine a really good programme earlier this week. We just caught it by accident, and it was Bear Grylls, the adventurer, and Johnny Wilkinson, the former England rugby player and now England rugby legend, Johnny Wilkinson, Bear Grylls, on this kind of outdoor adventure. And it's basically Bear Grylls putting Johnny through his paces and doing stuff that makes Johnny uncomfortable. He was kind of abseiling and going in potholes and doing scary things like that. Anyway, so, but if you don't know Johnny Wilkinson, he's an incredibly intense young man. And he's always been like that when he was playing for England. And he spoke a lot to Bear Grylls about how this intensity has both driven him, but also crushed him sometimes. But one just kind of phrase that Johnny Wilkinson said when he was talking to Bear Grylls was this: children don't listen. And we all know that. Yeah. Children don't listen. They observe. And it really struck me as I heard that, that what we say is not as important as how we behave and what we do. And this illustration here, Jesus's disciples, and if you don't know, the rabbinic disciple tradition was that Jewish disciples would literally follow in the footsteps of their rabbi. They would walk very close to them. They would observe their every waking moment of their life, and they would follow them around. And here, the disciples of Jesus are watching what he's doing. He's going to a certain place to pray. And they're like, Jesus, you haven't said anything here. Can you teach us how to do that? And so Jesus teaches them how to pray. And we know the prayer, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread and forgive us our trespasses. And then the other bit that was added on later, for thine is the kingdom, power and the glory. That's not in the Bible, but it was added on really close to, after Jesus's death. So Jesus models prayer as an act of being with his Father so that he can be with others. That's really important. He models a prayer of being with his Father in order that he can effectively be with others. Jesus's inner prayer life was a necessary and intentional discipline to enable him to complete his mission and purpose. As his life got harder, the moments of being with his Father and intimately with his closest disciples got more frequent and more fervent. From that structure of Luke chapter 11, where teach us to pray, and we have this kind of formatted prayer, to the painful intensity of Gethsemane, where he sweat drops of blood in prayer. For some Christians, literally translates as little Christs, some Christians today, the opposite's true. When life gets hard and the thunder roars and the storms swell, they stop praying in silence and stillness. And all this does is makes the cavern between us and the storm bigger. Between us in the storm and God above the storm, bigger. The cavern grows when we stop being still and silent. We can be guilty of only taking time to pray in stillness and silence when we've got time to spare. And that's a bit like only being generous when we've got enough money not to miss it. Jesus's model is the opposite. He has time for nothing else until he's made time to pray. Be still and be silent often. In answering the disciples' request for a prayer lesson, Jesus makes no allowances for different character types. Before any of us say, well, I'm an extrovert, so I can't pray and be still and be silent often. Jesus makes no allowances for that. He doesn't say in response to the teach us to pray question, well, if you're a loud extrovert, pray like this. But if you're a shy introvert, pray like this. He says to all of us, all of the disciples, in both words and by demonstration, so he speaks it and shows it, when you pray, go into the room, into your room, close the door, pray to your Father who is unseen. Then your Father who sees what is done in secret will reward you. And when you pray, do not keep on babbling like pagans, for they think they will be heard because of their many words. Matthew 6:6-7, which will have been on the screen for you to read too. So our Lent study series has been looking at Jesus's prayer life. This week we looked at the longest recorded prayer of Jesus in John chapter 17, known as the High Priestly Prayer. This prayer illustrates perfectly Jesus's trifold purpose for why it is so important to pray, be still, be silent, often. So, firstly, John chapter 17, verses 1 to 5. I'm just going to read that to you. John records Jesus like this. Father, the time has come. Glorify the Son, that your Son may glorify you. For you granted him authority over all people, that he might give eternal life to all those you have given him. Now this is eternal life, that they may know you, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom you have sent. I have brought you glory in the earth by completing the work you have given me to do. And now, Father, glorify me in your presence with the glory I had with you before the beginning. He celebrates the glory of the Father, acknowledging all that he is. He prays that his action in this world will magnify this glory. Just like the Lord's Prayer starts with words of worship and adoration, so Jesus begins his pre-crucifixion prayer with a moment to sit with God in his glory. Friends, this kind of prayer is impossible to do on the run. It's vital that you are physically still and audibly silent, often in the presence of the Father, so that you can truly drink in this glory. When we rely on praying on the run, we redact our prayer life into platitudes and selfish petitions only. Pray. Be still. Be silent. Often. Secondly, Jesus prays that all that he has drunk in of the Father's glory will reflect into the lives of his closest disciples. John chapter 17, verses 8 and 9 say, "For I gave them the words you gave me, and they accepted them. They knew with certainty that I came from you, and they believed that you sent me. I pray for them. I am not praying for the world, but for those you have given me, for they are yours." He spent time with these people, and they are his closest relationships. Our intercession for those we love the most will be rooted in our love of, appreciation of, and reflection of God's glory when we pray, are still and silent often. We will be less swayed by the tabloid-style headline prayer life and concerned deeply for our loved ones' souls as we pray for them. After all, if our life is rooted in worship of the Father, don't we want that to affect our closest relationships? Being truly with those we love should be a matter of prayer, and being with them in worship is the deepest connection we as humans can have. Pray, be still, be silent often. It will change your life and it will change the lives of those closest to you. Thirdly, and potentially finally, Jesus says, prays for those that will follow, you and I, that they will be unified so that the world will believe in him. Verses 22 to 24 of John chapter 17 say, "I have given them the glory that you gave me, that they may be one as we are one, I in them and you in me. May they be brought to complete unity to let the world know that you sent me and have loved them even as you have loved me. Father, I want those you have given me to be with me where I am and to see my glory, the glory you have given me because you loved me before the creation of the world." This is a prayer of mission. Do you pray for unity? Being with this world is tough. Being with those who we know and love deeply is one thing, but being with a world we don't know is deeply challenging. The root of the word community breaks down to with, com, and unity. As Father, Son, and Holy Spirit are with each other in com unity, Jesus prays that we follow, those that follow are with unity in community so that the world will believe in him. So that the world will believe in him. Unified is missional. If being with unity is the tool of mission for us, the church, then it's vital that this is one of the three central sections of our prayer life, as it was for Jesus. Pray, be still, be silent, often. So, some questions for you to ponder before we reflect with some music. How are you doing with this mark? Praying, being still, being silent, often? Is the current storm and intensity of your life driving you deeper or further away from the glory of God? Do you enjoy his presence just because of who he is? If not, pray, be still, be silent often. When you pray, do you make it a time when that's the only priority for that time? Social media off, TV off. How mindful are you of the glory of God when you pray? Are your prayers for those closest to you rooted in your experience of the glory of God? Is your deepest concern for those you love the most their soul or their comfort? Do you pray that the church, Christ's presence in our age, will be with unity, community, with God, with each other, with the world?
Thank you. show me.